Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, Professor Dr. Mukhtar, for kind words. Now, what my job was, in fact, I wanted my US friends who are, you know, not sleeping, and they are my seniors, my friends, my collaborators. But they said, it's good that I try to introduce the topic, why Academy thought about this topic, ANSO and Academy, beside MAAP also. We three organizations thought about this topic, and the reason was that the role of biodiversity, why we had this pandemic in the first instance, what was the reason, and was this the last pandemic, and if not, how to prevent the next pandemic? So these are a few questions that I'm trying to introduce, and you can see this picture down. This is this year's last month picture from our Cholistan and all that region where Dr. Mukhtar served also. That last month was unprecedentedly warm in that region, had no rainfall. We were striving for water in the region, and that's why we see all these deaths of not only animals, but humans too. So that is the reason of the climate change that we are expecting. So this climate change, let's see, what is one health and why we talk about this, advocating all this? Health is health. But I would quote the WHO one sentence, no one is safe unless everybody is safe. So you have to make safety of the whole, not only the humans, but the environment and the animals. And if you look at all of them, the emerging zoonotic diseases that are there, I will be telling you, I'm trying to keep that time in mind. And the reasons I have simplified, first in one health in the on the left corner, environment, animals, humans, treating their health as one. You keep your environment healthy, yourself healthy, human healthy, with the animals too. They have their rights. Otherwise, if you kill them, the parasite that are living in them, you offer yourself as a good host for those parasite to come in and live in you. And that's why you get it. On the other side, what are you doing, guy? Go back to the slide, please. Back. Yeah, make it bigger, no? Like it was before. So this is what we are talking about, emerging zoonotic diseases. So if you look at the right side, the reason was wildlife farming, market live animals that were traded. People eat wild animals, they do it. Wildlife hunting and domestic animals. People live with the animals, and these are the reasons of either accepting disease from the animals or giving disease to the animals too. There's two ways. Next, please. So that's why if you look at all this historical that I tried to kept it a very simple, this shows you the pandemic that we had in the history. This was not the biggest one, Corona. You feel it the biggest because you are living in it. But we had experience in 1918, for example, the number of deaths at that time, 50 million deaths. And imagine the population of 100 years back and today is different. We are now 7 billion at that time. We were not that big. And look at this data that we are having, all those diseases that we got in time. You will see that with the HIV is another one that we got from the animals. And so forth and so on. So what I'm saying is, the bottom line is the scientists now are of the opinion that if you spend around 20 billion per year to save the biodiversity, you will have a better chance to avoid the next pandemic. So that's why these are the few of the approaches of One Health that we would try as a so-called civilized animals, humans, to invest on the biodiversity to save our lively planet, the only planet that we have. Otherwise, we are really going towards disaster. And look at this, the reasons for all this pandemic that we had. Number one, long tradition of eating wild animals. This is how it originated too, in the wet market that we had. And then food and traditional medicines. that for the medicine, we use animals in some of the Chinese medicine, our traditional medicine, worldwide traditional medicine, they use live parts of live animal. And then 8 billion people of maintain roughly 30 billion food animals. Because of your population growth, because of the human population, you eat more animals, you have more animals on planet. If you are less, you would have consumed less animals. And then those animals that they, their fishes, their secretions, that are also contributed to the environment then, and that's how they come from it. 4 trillion kilogram of fecal matter from the animals that we are contributing to the environment. That's how you are getting all this. So, and the third thing is that those animals and human, the antibiotic that we are using, and we are heading towards another disaster, what we call it antibiotic resistance, both in animal and human and plants. And that's how you will be really 2 billion people, you will be astonished to read these figures, 2 billion people around the world eat insects. So you may be thinking, because I was in one of the Japanese, having picnic, and at evening there were big insect came and they just on a chopstick, oishi, this means very tasty. And I was like, vomiting. So that is the traditions in different countries that we have, and that is how we could really think about how can we meet. So now with these infectious diseases, the reasons are why we are having it. Number one, decline of biodiversity, the cutting of forest, the killing of animals. And that's why the reduced biodiversity transmit infectious diseases to humans, animals, and plants. And then loss of frequently increases disease transmission. And finally, you can prevent this if you intact this ecosystem and their endemic biodiversity, that will reduce the prevalence of infectious diseases. Here, one of the important thing that I want, we are living in a region specifically Pakistan, China, Nepal, all this, that we are in Himalaya, Karakoram, and Hindu Kush. This region that we have, we are very rich in biodiversity. We have glaciers. We depend on the glaciers because that melts and we get water, all this, and the indigenous people that depend on it. So the data, if you look, nearly 2 billion people live in its, on this river basins. Because of that, you have crops, you have agriculture, et cetera, and that's how this is the most important region of the world. If you don't save this, the human will suffer all around the globe. Because of all this, that we are very rich, luckily, in this region that we have. Look at Pakistan, the only country in the world that stretches from 0 meter to 8,611 meter. No other country in the world, the unique country. But to what are you doing with the biodiversity is another story that you have to think about. So if you want to prevent the spillover, what should you do? Number one, as I said, $20 billion annually to save the biodiversity and to save the global deforestation. And then drastically curtail and regulate trade of, these are the four principles. If you follow this, you can really have a major chance to avoid next pandemic. Like you can curtail trade of wild animals. You have the ability, you have capacity building. All these young people, why we are having this workshop? One of the reasons for the next pandemic that they will be trained in this. This is one of the component of the project to train capacity build of the youth so that they understand and they know how to detect the infectious disease. Dr. Ali, who has this project, will have all the bats of Pakistan, and they will extract all the possible viruses from the bats, and then we will report with Chinese colleague and work for, to see the future viruses that we have. Another, Dr. Iftikhar is sitting here, who is really expert in virology and doing a lot of good things. He has several new species reported of the microorganisms that are working. So we are proud, we are having these kind of very intellectual people of IT, AI, artificial intelligence, everybody is sitting here. Human health specialists. So we are doing all this because of to invest in these people's health and economic security to reduce the risk. So if we look at another one that is coming up, monkeypox, the almost 20 countries got it. And we are worried that this is the next one that is coming up. So we have to be really careful. If you use the clothes of the people, we are close to the animals. This is how we get it. And then it can be spread again. If by coughing, by all this, that are various reasons. So this is a rare disease that's coming up in US too had been reported. And you have the respiratory droplets during direct and prolonged, you know, face-to-face contact. So again, that's how we need really to save. So how, this is what in a very short slide, I tried to see the ecosystems mitigation and management of COVID-19 and other zoonoses. If you look at this, the upper one, unimpacted, and if you look at the bottom, degraded kind of situation, what you get. So these arrows will tell you, how will you get all these diseases if you really don't care of the wealth that you have. So that's very important if you could save. And in this first slide, what we call it steep technology. And that steep means social, technological, economic, environmental, systematic linkages with political and governance system. I'm not reading all for you. You may get the slides. I will try to send it to you. So these are the steep things that we have to look after all these. If you really want to save the next pandemic, that is that from social, technological, economic, political, environmental, that is the system linkages. If we could do that, we really can save the next pandemic that is coming up. So the finally, what I would like to tell you is ecosystem damage and human health risks. That's what we have. So if we are damaging this ecosystem, ladies and gentlemen, we are damaging ourselves. So that is that we really we have to think about the loss of habitat, modification of natural environment, the houses that you are building, the land that you are clearing for agriculture, etc. All this can happen, and this is how you do it. The breeding sites you are reducing, wild animal that you have, loss of predatory species that you do in the process, transfer of pathogens, etc., etc. So you guys have to look after your surroundings, and you be the ambassador of saving all this earth, the only earth that we have, if you want to save yourself. So from COVID-19 crisis to the opportunity to rethink about risk, this when we say, challenges and opportunity, we can really now learn from this pandemic and avoid another pandemic. That is, call on policymaker, how the evidence-based, integrated, interconnectedness domains of disaster risk reduction, climate change, and sustainable development. Governments have to work together. This was the nice time of collaboration. This event is an example of excellent collaboration of three organizations, MAAP, Academy, and ANSO, to produce such an event that at least globally people are now listening to us. There are more than 300 people online listening to us, all this talk that we are having. And MAAP will be very pleased to have every quarterly, I'm sure Dr. Mukhtar at the end will announce another event hosted by him in his university on using skills of the things, linking AI, artificial intelligence, and computer, et cetera, et cetera. I think we will design an event, AFAQ will be, with the blessings of the Vice Chancellor. The MAAP will be very pleased to host another event with you in your university. A big hand to the Vice Chancellor so that he announces it out here. And call on the, if I could finally talk a little bit about this, all these issues that we are, why we had all this? These are the statistics. If you look at 31% land use changes as responsible. Urbanization, reducing forest for clearing for agriculture land, 15% of agriculture, 13% of international, export of wildlife, etc. And all this. This is the data. This is calculated that why we got all this pandemic and why we will be getting in the future. This is a simple representation of the whole. This is a data of 60 years. From 1940 to 2004. This is an assemblage of the computer data explaining. And these are the regions susceptible for next pandemic. This yellowish is the high risk. And Pakistan is very close to that. And if you look at the Pakistan upper part, what we call it, northern areas of Pakistan, where it is rich in biodiversity, that is the most vulnerable side that we have to look after. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I wanted to set an example for the time so that you could follow the other one. Thank you, sir. And thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Is very kind. It's 1 o'clock in the morning, I think, on the East Coast side.